In the plan for a robust economic recovery, one cannot simply disregard infrastructure investment. Infrastructure is the key to economic growth. It is the dynamic platform upon which development can grow and can grow. It is for this reason that the Department of Transportation, despite all the difficulties caused by the pandemic, continued and intensified the implementation of the Build program to stimulate economic growth and achieve sustainable recovery. Ladies and gentlemen, let me walk you through on what the Department of Transportation has done and continue to do to achieve the fruits of the Build program and reach the golden age of infrastructure. Let us then revisit one by one the sectors within the Department of Transportation. First on the line is the aviation and airports sector. Ladies and gentlemen, if you will look on the screen, the map of the Philippines, you see on the screen the map of the Philippines, all those colored in purple are all the developments, programs, and projects done in the archipelago. You will please observe that in almost all the major islands, in almost all the regions and the provinces, there has been aviation projects that are completed and ongoing projects. Let me state for the record that when we speak of the airport projects, right now as I speak, there are 233 airport projects, including the start and completion of projects which has been dormant or pending for many, many years and several decades involving many, many administrations. For instance, after 11 years of delay and three groundbreaking ceremonies prior to this administration, we have finally inaugurated in the month of October of this year the Bicol International Airport. We have also completed this year the new second passenger terminal building of the Clark International Airport, which has unique features such as contactless baggage handling, contactless passengers check-in and check-out, contactless ordering system, and the establishment of the Heroes Lounge for our soldiers and policemen and people in uniform and the overseas Filipino workers. You can look at the screen and see for yourself the difference between what Clark International Airport then, when we assume, and what Clark International Airport now is. You will see the glaring difference, and you will see indeed that from what it was when we first assumed, you can say that really we can take pride in looking at the new Clark International Airport with all the amenities world-class that has been introduced into the airport. We have the Mactan International Airport. This is the new passenger terminal building, which was inaugurated on June 7, 2018. This is the world's friendliest resort airport. Capacity, 8.5 million passengers per year. And in addition to the changes and renovations done at the airport, we are now starting to finalize the second runway at the Cebu International Airport, which second runway expect to be operational partially in April of 2022. In addition to this, to add to the beauty of the landscape of the Clark International Airport, we included the new building, which added beauty to the skyline of the Mactan International Airport. The six-story corporate office building is equipped with modern equipment and facilities for the convenience facility and protection of the workers and staff. If you will look at the screen, you will see the beauty that is now in the skyline of the Mactan Cebu International Airport. The other is the Bohol Panglao International Airport. The Bohol Panglao International Airport, listen to this, ladies and gentlemen, began its feasibility study in year 2000, and construction started only in June of 2015. Now, in the term of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, we have completed the Bohol Panglao International Airport, the country's first eco airport with a capacity of 3.4 million passengers a year. This Panglao International Airport has been declared as the eco airport in the Philippines. Now, if you will look at the screen, you will see what Bohol Panglao International Airport was when we started in April 2016. You look at the Panglao International Airport now, as it is being operational, world class, an airport that really not only people from Bohol, but the entire Filipino people can be truly proud of. Then we have the General Santos Airport. This is an airport which we just inaugurated on 23 September of this year. This new rehabilitated and renovated airport boasts of expansion and rehabilitation of passenger terminal building, expansion of vehicular parking area, and the construction of drain and storm drainage. The capacity, 2 million passengers per year compared to its pre-pandemic capacity of 1 million passengers. This is a development in Mindanao. Ladies and gentlemen, I take your attention now to look at the screen and see for yourself what the General Santos Airport was again when we assume, and what the General Santos Airport now that we are about to complete the term of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. You can witness for yourself the dramatic and colorful change that is in Yansan. The other is the Zamboanga International Airport. You will note, as shown in the map earlier, that we have projects all over the archipelago. The Zamboanga International Airport is another airport which we have renovated and improved on. This was inaugurated again on 28 September of 2021. This airport boasts of expanded and rehabilitated passenger terminal building, the repair of the runway, the upgrading and asphalt overlay. There is now a rehabilitated taxiway. And more importantly, we have introduced the Zamboanga Airport Malasakit Hall for all purpose and the GAD All Purpose Center. The Zamboanga International Airport is now ready for international operations. Capacity, 300 passengers per year compared to only 180,000 passengers per year pre-pandemic. Now, if you are to appreciate what we have done at the Zamboanga International Airport, let us look at what Zamboanga International Airport then when we assume, and what the Zamboanga International Airport now that we are in this administration. Look at the difference. This is one situation, another situation where you, as a Filipino, can take pride that we have really improved and renovated and constructed new airports that we can really be truly proud of. There are also other airports which we have put up. The Sikihor Airport, this is inaugurated on August 26. We have constructed a new passenger terminal building, power hubs, and we have expanded the vehicular parking area of the Sikihor Airport. Capacity, 60 passengers at any one time. Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. when we assumed the capacity was only for 10 passengers at a time. If you will look at what Sikihor Airport then as what Sikihor Airport now, you will say that the previous Sikihor Airport, you look like a roadside cafe, sari-sari store. But now we have an airport that one can be truly be very proud of. We have also another airport that we have constructed at Katarman. This is Northern Samar. Look, it's so beautiful. Although it is small compared to the other international airport, you can say that this is a beautiful airport with a capacity of 100 passengers or around 50,000 passengers annually at any given time, from the previous of 50 passengers per day. Now, look at the Katarman Airport and take a look at what Katarman Airport was when we assumed. It looks like a parking shed, but now the Katarman Airport is really an airport that we can all be truly proud of. Not to be forgotten, Camiguin. Who of you have been to Camiguin of late? Look at the airport that is in Camiguin right now. You can see on the screen the passenger capacity and what we have done. Compare this to the Camiguin airport to what it was when we assumed. Please don't smile, but that is the reality. That is the Camiguin airport. Ito ho yung nadatnan namin when we arrived. Ito ho yung Camiguin airport na iiwanan namin pag alis namin. And so, this in glimpse is what we have done in so far as the aviation and the airport sector is concerned. The Philippines is an archipelago. That is a matter of truth. Now, let us look again at the map of the Philippines. Please flash on the screen the map of the Philippines. Look at the map of the Philippines. This is an archipelago. The purple shades signify what we have done in so far as the maritime projects are concerned. And then you will say that indeed, really, as of this date, we have covered all the archipelago with maritime projects, completed and ongoing seaport commercial projects. Let us take a look at some of them. Of late, so we have simultaneously inaugurated Bohol Airport projects. This included the Port of Maribohok, the Port of Luon, Talibon, Hagna, and other places. The handler of the video is getting too fast with this tic-tac toe. Anyway, flash on the screen is the Port of Takbilaran. Look at what the Port of Takbilaran was when we are sure. It looked like you see the and you see the remnant of typhoons. Very sad indeed. But look at the new Port of Takbilaran now. Again, you will see a booming industry because the facility has been expanded and improved. There are also other ports, like the Port of Hagna. I will, in the interest of time, I will flash on the screen the various ports, and please observe the comparison of what the ports are when we assume as what the ports are when we will be leaving. The here and now of the Port of Hagna. As they say in Tagalog, noon kawawa naman, ngayon masaya na ang tao sa Port of Hagna. There is also the Port of Ubay. Same observation. Look, the Port of Ubay, when we assume, look like the forgotten remnant of World War II. But look at the Port of Ubay now. As we look, you can be truly be proud of and say, indeed, improvement has come in Bohol. Port of Tapal is a similar story. Port of Talibon is a similar story. So The first picture showing what port of Taliban now and the port of Taliban then. You will see that the port of Taliban then looks like the evacuation days after World War. But now you see a really world-class port of Taliban where business is booming right now. And that goes to show with port of Luon in Bicol, in Bohol. You see the difference? One is a forgotten place, one is a cherished place. Simultaneous inaugurations were also done in Mindoro. So that if you will see improvements in Bohol, you will now see improvements in the Mindoro Port projects. Let us take a look at the Mindoro Port projects. The Port of Balatero, same observation, forgotten ports to a port that is to be cherished. The Port of Rojas in Oriental Mindoro, the then and now. Look at how it looked when we assume. And again, take a look at what it is now that we are living and ending the term of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. Same is happening with the other ports. The port of Mansalay, look at the difference. There is the port of Bulalakaw, observe the difference. Noon, nakakahiya, ngayon, nakakatuwa. The port of Mansod, you can see what it was then, and you can see what it is now. The port of Calapan cannot be, I have to underscore the port of Calapan. If you will look down under, we have the new passenger terminal building presently ongoing. The capacity of this terminal building, which will be completed by the first quarter of next year, is for 3,500 passengers. Never before has the Philippines been benefited of a passenger terminal whose capacity is 3,500. We are cheering and we are happy with the birth of the Port of Calapan being the biggest terminal, soon to be the biggest terminal in the Philippines, 3,500 capacity. There is also the Port of Abra de Ilong in Occidental Mindoro. Look at the difference, what it is now and what it was then. We have also completed simultaneously projects in Palawan. You say Palawan is, a tourism site, correct. But now that we have completed airport and port projects in Palawan, we can say that Palawan is now turning itself into a business hub. So that flash on the screen, you will see what we have done with the various ports in Palawan. You can really be very proud of the Palawan province now in terms of tourism potentials and in terms of business activities. Plus on the screen, you will see the port of Puerto Princesa. You will see the port of San Fernando. You will see the port of Bora. And you will say, really, with the port of Matarasa, you have seen a complete transformation insofar as the maritime landscape of Puerto Princesa is concerned. You know one good thing about Puerto Princesa? One good thing about Puerto Princesa is that the connectivity is not only limited now within Visayas and Mindanao. The connectivity now extends to other ASEAN countries like the Binayaga, Sabah, Indonesia. All these are interconnected now because of the various port developments we have done. We have also done cruise ports where the international ports can really park and land, adding to the tourism movement and the business potentials of the place. Not to be forgotten are the Pag-asa projects which we have put in Palawan to help assure not only connectivity and mobility, but also improve on the security and safety of the place. Flash on the screen is self-explanatory pictorial on the Pangasa Island Sheltered Port Project Phase 1. I mentioned about Port of Calapan earlier that will boost of 3,500 passenger capacity. Listen to this. By the first quarter of next year, we will also complete the Port of Zamboanga with a capacity of 4,000 passengers at any given time. The Duterte administration is the period in time in the country where we are enjoying passenger terminal with a capacity of 3,000 in General Santos, 3,000 in as earlier presented, and 3,500, and now 4,000 in the port of Zamboanga. Indeed, changes and improvements have occurred in the maritime landscape of the Philippines. Let me walk you through some social tourism projects before I make an announcement. Please look at the screen. These social tourism port projects have been done all over the country. Let me call your attention in the Pangasinan Riverside Improvement. Before we constructed this, in the two banks of the river, before you go from one bank to another, the students going to school will take easily 2 to 3 hours before they can go to their destination. With the projects like this, the riverside landing, river landing, we have reduced actually the travel time from 2.5 hours to only 20 to 30 minutes, thus helping in the academic pursuits of the children as we are helping in the fishing activities of the area. We have put up social tourism projects all over the country. And to underscore the efforts which we have done insofar as the social and tourism port projects, you can look at the screen on what we have done. Announcement. Next week, we will inaugurate 143 social tourism port projects in one day. There will be simultaneous inauguration of social tourism port projects, 143 all in all, in one day. Never, never has this been done in the history of the Philippines, only during the time of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. Look at all those beautiful social ports which we have put up, adding to the improvement of the livelihood of the places as well as its tourism potentials. We are giving you a glimpse of the various social tourism port projects which we will be inaugurating next week. All in all, 140 simultaneous inauguration. Really, this is one activity where we can be proud of. Let me just touch a little bit on the Philippine Coast Guard. Creating all the infrastructure sector, we are also adding security and safety by enhancing and improving the Philippine Coast Guard headquarters and facilities. You will see that we have completed the Coast Guard station at Kalayaan. You will see that we have completed the Coast Guard station at Western Visayas. This is our all in addition to the facilities which we have put up. Also, the Philippine Coast Guard has renovated and improved on the various lighthouses, not only in Palawan, but all over the country. Flash on the screen, we will give you a glimpse of what kind of lighthouses we have finished and completed. You know, when the Duterte administration assumed its term, the lighthouses were used for many other things, for the purposes it is or it was intended. Now, the lighthouses can be used as a tool for maritime safety, and the lighthouses can also be what we call a tourism facility for tourists and local people alike to enjoy. Plus on the screen are some of the lighthouses which we have renovated and improved. Let us now take a look at the railways. You know, when we started our administration, let me give you a bird's eye view of what was the DOTR railways profile then, what is the DOTR railways profile now, and what we expect it to be in year 2022. If you will look, by 2016, when we assume the length of railways is only 77 kilometers. Now, as we speak, we have completed totally operational, ongoing construction or awarded 395 kilometers. As we move on to year 2002, our target is to achieve 1,209 kilometers. Remember that we are doing this notwithstanding pandemic. In other words, pandemic is another challenge for us to be able to do projects like this, but the pandemic will not distract and stop us from doing projects of this nature. Before we had 61 stations. Now as we speak, we have 87 stations fully operational. We expect by the end of 2022 to have put up 170 stations. On the train capacity, when we assume there were 224 trains, now we have 189 train cars and we want to have 1,386 train cars. 2016, the only contract that had been awarded on the rail projects was 9. 2021, as of today, we have already signed, executed, and implemented 38 contracts. We intend to achieve and finalize 70 contracts before the end of President Duterte's term. Let us take a look of some of the railway projects. LRT2 East Extension. This is the route that travels Marikina, Pasig, and Antipolo. Length of 3.8 kilometers. This has been pending, you know, since many years ago. Four administration, 2 decades pending. We have completed this in the Duterte administration. We have reduced travel time between Manila and Antipolo from 2 hours to just 40 minutes. Capacity, additional 80,000 passengers per day. Inaugurated on July 2021. We started operation on July 5, 2021. Completed project. The common station. The construction of the common station was installed for many, many years. Where you see big business tycoons and business taipans fighting each other. This was originally approved by NEDA ICC on 13 December 2006 as part of the LRT1 North Extension project. Now, we will have a 13,700 square meters concourse area. December 21, 2021, capacity 500,000 passengers per day. Timeline, Area B, we have completed the same. Area A, We will complete the construction on December 2021 with signaling and systems by 2022. You will soon see the completion of the common station in Quezon City. The MRT rehabilitation project. When we joined government in 2016, the MRT3 gave us really nightmares. Everyone was calling us names about the MRT3 projects. Keep shouting, then Mirumura kami. They were doubting. It is as if we created the MRT3 problems. The MRT3, we did not create the problem. We are here and we were here to give the solutions to the MRT3. And these solutions will involve no longer unloading incidents. It runs at 60 kilometers per hour compared to 30 kilometers per hour. It will reduce train interval from 8 to 9 minutes to only 4 minutes. Running trains now are 23 compared to what it was when we joined 10 to 15. All the 46 escalators and 30 pole elevators are now operational. Ladies and gentlemen, we will complete the rehabilitation of MRT3 by December of this year ahead of the schedule. Of course, much has been said about the PNR Clark projects from Tutuban to Manila to Malolos in Bulacan. This is a project that is now 48% completed. Length is 37.9. We intend to reduce travel time between Tutuban and Malolos from 1 hour to 30 minutes to just 35 minutes. Again, the capacity is 300,000 passengers per day. Let me give you the project timeline so that you will have the confidence that soon the PNR Clark Phase 1 will be operational. The first train set are arriving or has started to arrive December 2021. The simulator is arriving December 2021. We shall have three runs on June 2023. And the final and full operations will be at the latest on the second quarter of 2024. If we have PNR Clark Phase 1, we also have PNR Clark Phase 2. This is from Malolos, Bulacan to Clark, Pampanga. You know, this project is really very, very close to my heart, having worked as president of CDC at one time. The progress now of PNR Clark Phase 2 is 33%. We aim to reduce travel time between Malolos and Clark from 1 hour and 30 minutes, just 35 minutes. This run features the first airport railway express, which is connected to the Clark International Airport and will reduce travel time between Makati and Clark to just 55 minutes. Capacity, ladies and gentlemen, is 150 passengers per day. To give you the confidence, allow me to state the various project timelines. Trial run, third quarter of 2024. Partial operability, third quarter of 2023. Full operations will be on 2024. Flash on the screen, you will see the actual constructions that are going on. In other words, you can say that the PNR Clark projects is not all about talk, talk, talk. It's all about work, work, work. It's all about build, build, build. Soon, the dream of the Filipino people to have the PNR Clark will stop to be a dream and will soon become a reality. MRT7, this provides the connectivity from North Avenue and Quezon City up to San Jose del Monte. If I tell you that actual construction of MRT7 is started in 2016, 20 years after the receipt of the unsolicited proposal for MRT7 on August 27, 2001. Concession agreement was signed in 18 August 2008. I tell you now, ladies and gentlemen, this MRT7 North Avenue, Quezon City, San Jose del Monterrey will be reducing travel time from 2 to 3 hours to just 35 minutes. I tell you, partial operability trial run will be 2022 April next year. Full operations will be 2022 fourth quarter of next year. Isn't that a thing of beauty? Of course, we also have LRT1 Cavite extension, Baclaran Parañaque Nyug to Bacoor. The first NEDA ICC approval was received on 25 August year 2000, and the right of way acquisition started as far back in year 2007. This involves 11.7 kilometer extension. This hopes to reduce travel time between Baclaran and Bacoor from 1 hour 10 minutes down to only 25 minutes. Capacity will be between 500,000 to 800,000. Now you will see the, in the project timeline, the viaduct completion, Baclaran Depot. The LRBs delivered December 2021. 5 extension completed by April 2022. Baclaran trial run March 2023. Baclaran to Dr. Santos Avenue first quarter of 2024. This is a project that many of the Cavitenos, many of the people in Parañaque, and many of the people in Metro Manila has been dreaming to have. Soon, that dream will be a reality because of the Duterte administration. And of course, the Metro Manila subway. People are asking what happened to Metro Manila subway. This is a project that involves 33 kilometers that aim to reduce travel time between Quezon City and Maia from 1 hour and 10 minutes to just 35 minutes. Capacity, 370,000 passengers. Project timelines. Partial operability, the PRI building, East Valenzuela Station Depot, first quarter of 2022. Trial run, April 2022. Full operation of the subway is third quarter of 2027. Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. The idea of subway in Metro Manila was first proposed almost half a century in 1973 under the Urban Transport Study in Manila metropolitan area. Now, in the term of President Duterte, it is now being transformed into a reality where the Filipino people will really enjoy their first subway experience. Flash on the screen are other projects. In the interest of time, I ask you to look into it, and you will have the confidence and assurance that we are working double time, triple time, quadruple time in order that we achieve the objectives which we have in so far as the rail projects in the Philippines are concerned. Let's now revisit what we are happening or what we are doing at the road transport and infrastructure sector. Many of you have seen the EDSA busway. This EDSA busway is a product which was accelerated because of the pandemic. This dedicated median lane for city buses in EDSA significantly reduced travel time between Monumento and Pasay from 2 to 3 hours to just 40 to 50 minutes. You will note But this is a project that is undergoing what I call childbirth pains. Soon we hope that the situation at the Ed Sabatoy will become ideal following the experience and the development in other parts of the world. We also have the Metropolitan Bike Lane Networks. We have completed, ladies and gentlemen, 100% of the 497 kilometers bike lane network in Metro Manila, Metro Cebu, and Metro Davao, complete with pavement markings, bollard curbs, and solar studs. Latest development, we are talking with that it be included in the traffic signs and the traffic map of in the Google map. In the last couple of days, I have communicated to Google to make sure that our completed metropolitan bike lane are included in the Google map. And perhaps supporting us in this endeavor are certain legislations coming up now, institutionalizing bike lanes in other parts of the country. You know, when people were finding hard to go to the offices of LTO, I told LTO, if the people cannot go to the offices because our offices are far-flung, I want our offices to go to the people. And that is why we were able to construct 112 LTO new offices nationwide, consisting of district offices, new extension offices, driver's license renewal offices. Not to be outdone is LTFRB that also put up 4 new offices. And the construction of new offices is ongoing today. As I said, if the people find it difficult and hard for one reason or another to go to the offices of LTO and LTFRB, we will bring the offices, and we should bring the offices to the people. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the projects which we have done so far. You know, I would like to add at this point, while we do these projects, there are 2 platforms and 2 tools which we use in undertaking this project in order that we achieve what I call transparency, accountability, and credibility. What are these? The tool of digitization, that's one. And we are adopting digitization all over all the sectors, rails, aviation, maritime, and road. We are also doing really a program of absolutely no corruption. So these are the 2 platforms where we stand when we undertake these projects, digitization and no corruption. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the highlights of the accomplishment of the Department of Transportation during the term of our beloved President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. The delivery of this project and initiative is our way of fulfilling the marching order of the President to provide a comfortable and a convenient life for the Filipino people. With you, and in this road to recovery, we believe that this project will chart our path to the golden age of infrastructure. Allow me now to abuse your patience by asking another 1 minute to show you a recap of what I have mentioned. A recap, one minute video to show a recap of what the Department of Transportation has done. With your due indulgence, a 1 minute video presentation, please. Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, you saw it right. The Department of Transportation with its three major agencies, the PPA, the Manila International Airport, and the civil, CAP, has remitted to the national government 57.7 billion in actual cash remittance in a period only of 4.5 years. With that, thank you very much for your time, and I hope I have given you some thoughts to ponder. Maraming salamat po. Thank you very much.